Good morning, Resurrection people. It's Pastor Jedediah. Good to be with you in worship this morning. I am greeting you from my home. As you can see, things are going to be a little bit different as we move forward under these stay-at-home restrictions. You will see that the band is playing on the stage during worship. Just know that we pre-recorded everything in the event that we had to stay at home. So this team has been working hard to make sure that your experience this morning felt as inclusive and real as they could make it. Thanks for joining us in worship. If you want to send us a picture in the comments of who's sitting on the couch with you, if you want to share your prayer requests below as we gather in this time of worship, you are welcome to. We're just glad that you're joining us. May God bless you as we enter in.
We see you. you know our hearts. You know how quickly we will stand up to shout your hosannas while we hold back from letting you into our whole lives. Forgive us for keeping parts of ourselves hidden from you and for all the things weighing on our hearts today that we know are not right in your eyes.
Today is the start of Holy Week, when our Savior began his journey to the cross. As Jesus rode through Jerusalem and the people shouted his praises, he knew these same people would shout, "Crucify," days later. He died for them, like he died for each of us, and through his sacrifice, we are forgiven.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into
I am forgiven.
Hey, Pastor Jedediah again. Now's our time in worship where we get to give our tithes and our offerings. I want to remind some of you that have found this season of COVID-19 to be financially impacting your family. I want to tell you that your praise, your thanksgiving, and your prayers today in worship are your gift to God. Thank you. I also want to tell you that as a congregation, we've tried our best to be financially responsible through this season. We have frozen all of our spending. We've approached our mortgage company and asked for a 3-month reprieve, but we are continuing to invest in the most important thing to bring ministry and hope beyond the walls of Resurrection. And that's our team, our staff. They have been working hard to continue to minister beyond our walls and to bring encouragement to you. If you'll look on our website, you'll find a whole list of tools given to our preschool, our youth, elementary age, even up to our adults, to keep our faith triangles strong and growing. Hopefully you find those to be helpful through this season, because I expect that we come out the other side of this stronger than when we went in. Now, just from a financial aspect, we had a number of people over the last week lean in and say, we haven't been hit financially as hard as others have. We can give more. And I'm so grateful for those who have been able to do that in this time. We're in this together. Now is the time to give if you can, out of a sense of generosity, out of a sense of thanksgiving. If you have your app open, you can give there. You can go online, or if you just want to write a check and send it to the Resurrection Monticello address, you can do that as well. May God bless you as you give in worship.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, the darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend. In the goodness of God.
With my life laid down, I'm surrendered.
of God, I will sing of the goodness of God.
1 John chapter 5 verses 13 to 20. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we asked of him. If anyone sees his brother commit a sin that does not lead to death, he should pray and God will give him life. I refer to those whose sin does not lead to death. There is a sin that leads to death. I am not saying that he should pray about that. All wrongdoing is sin, and there is sin that does not lead to death. We know that anyone born of God does not continue to sin. The one who was born of God keeps him safe, and the evil one cannot harm him. We know that we are children of God, and that the whole world is under the control of the evil one. We know also that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding, so that we may know him who is true. And we are in him who is true, even in his Son Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. Here ends the reading.
I'm glad you're here today. Let's start with a word of prayer. Father, would you come and would you meet us right here, wherever we may be, wherever we're watching this, wherever we're listening to it, would you speak to us through the power of your holy word? There are so many things out in the world that we're uncertain of about today, but there are some things that you've told us we can be absolutely certain of. So Holy Spirit, would you speak to us and lead us in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Hey, can I just tell you, this Sunday, there's a great celebration going on in the church. It's called Palm Sunday. Yeah, this is the beginning of what we call Holy Week. It's in this week that leads us up to Monday, Thursday, and Good Friday, when we see Jesus die, and then Easter morning, next Sunday. Well, just so you know, on this Sunday, Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. All the people there, they took their cloaks and the palm branches, and they threw them out on the road. And as Jesus rode by on that donkey, the people yelled out, "Hosanna! Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Now, just so that you know, Hosanna, the word Hosanna means rescue us, save us. Right words, wrong motivation. You see, the people then were looking for an earthly king, someone who would deliver them from under the hand of Roman rule. Jesus was there to rescue people, save people, but as the Messiah, the long-awaited one, the anointed one. The people saw another thing. They saw what they wanted to see, what they thought they needed, someone to save them, not from sin, but from the strong hand of the government. Well, today, amongst all that's going on in our world, it's so easy to see what we want to see, hear what we want to hear, and still not see what we're supposed to see or hear what we're supposed to hear. When disaster strikes, when it hits home too close, how are God's people supposed to respond besides weeping, besides panicking, besides being frustrated and wanting to give up, besides giving to the relief fund, besides volunteering our time, besides keeping our social distance? Well, can I just tell you, there's one thing that God's people can do more effectively than anyone else: pray. We're living in uncertain times. Everywhere I turn, in the print, on the news, on the social media, everyone is talking about this pandemic, this virus. Fears are rising all around the world. People who have never felt an anxious thought or had one before are suddenly weighed down with worry, and they're not sure what to do next. Schools are closed, travel is banned, events canceled, even churches' doors are shut. People are stockpiling hand sanitizer and toilet paper. Now, the hand sanitizer, I understand, but not so much the toilet paper. People do unpredictable things when they're motivated by fear and uncertainty. And in those uncertain times, the Bible assures us there are some truths that we can know for absolutely certain. The early church was no stranger to plagues and epidemics and mass hysteria. They experienced their fair share of uncertainty and even panic. So in 1 John chapter 5, the Apostle John directs believers' attention to five things that we can be certain about even in uncertain times and when hard times hit us at home. Five truths that can't be denied and will never change. Given the current climate of fear and uncertainty in our world, I thought today would be a great day to focus on the things that you and I can be absolutely certain and sure of. Now, if you have your Bible or you have an app for on your phone for your Bible, I would like you to follow along. Please follow along with me, 1 John chapter 5. We're going to look at verses 13 through 15. 1 John chapter 5 is towards the very end of the Bible. And if you find chapter 5, that's the bigger number, and then there's the smaller numbers that follow. So first of all, John tells us that we can be certain about our promise. Here's what he says. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know you have eternal life. As believers in Jesus Christ, we can know that we have eternal life. God has gone on record, put it in black and white, wrote it in His book, in His Word, as offering eternal life to everyone who believes in Jesus Christ. That's God's promise. Listen to just a few other verses in the Bible that assure us of the very same thing, eternal life. It says in John 3:36, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. In John chapter 5, verse 24, it says, very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. Yeah. John chapter 6, verse 47, very truly I tell you, the one who believes has eternal life. Now, I'm not sure how many more verses you want to hear, how many more times I need to say it before we really believe it. Life is full of letdowns and empty promises, but eternal life with Jesus won't be one of them. How do we know that Jesus knows what he's talking about? Because he's been there. Jesus has been to the grave, numbered among the dead, heart silent, lungs vacant, body wrapped, grave sealed. But then the miraculous happened. And the Message Bible says it this way in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 and 4. Because Jesus was raised from the dead, we've been given a brand new life and have everything to live for, including a future in heaven. In times of confusion, in times of fear, in times of uncertainty, the first truth that we can be absolutely certain is God's promise of eternal life. Now, next, John goes on to tell us that we can also be certain about our prayers. Follow along, verse 14 and 15. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. And if we know that He hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we've asked of Him. So the second truth of which we can be sure is that God hears and answers our prayers. Now more than ever, Christians ought to be responding, not in panic, but in prayer. We have so much to pray about. We need to pray for our medical leaders and teams that are taking care of lots of people. We need to pray for our decision makers. We need to pray for governments all around the world. We need to pray for the people who already are afflicted with this virus. We need to pray for those who are especially vulnerable, the elderly, those who are already sick or have immune deficiency. In uncertain times, it's so essential that Christians choose prayer over panic. And when we pray, we can be absolutely certain that God's listening. We know that He hears us. Now, in my experience, I don't always get what I pray for. Do you? As far as I can tell, there are four different answers that God will give according to our prayers. If the request is wrong, God says no. If the timing is wrong, God says slow. If you're wrong, God says grow. But if the request is right, the timing is right, and you're right, God says go. So how do we make sure that everything is right? Well, John answers that for us. If we ask anything according to his will, we have the request which we have asked from him. Pray in line with God's will, and you can pray with confidence. Prayer is not about getting my will done in heaven. It's about getting God's will done here on earth. God always says yes when our requests are in line with his desires. To pray effectively, then, we need to determine God's will. And to do that, we need to open up our Bibles. God's will is already laid out on the pages of Scripture. So turn to the commands of God's Word and request. Make the prayers found in God's Word your own. Pray God's promises back to Him. By using the Scriptures as the basis for your prayer life, you'll be sure to pray in a way that honors God, and then you can know that His answer will be yes. So we can be certain about our promise, we can be certain about our prayers, and third, we can be certain about our protection. John goes on to say in verse 18, we know that anyone born from God does not continue to sin. The one who was born of God keeps them safe, and the evil one cannot harm them. Now, John's not saying that Christians don't sin. In fact, in the first chapter of this book, he says that anyone who claims not to sin is a liar. We fall short just like everybody else. You don't have to be a Christian long to figure that out. Rather, what he's saying is that as Christians, we have a protector keeping us safe. The Son of God protects them. And again, John's not suggesting that Jesus always protects us from physical harm or illness or financial ruin or relational problems. Rather, Jesus protects us from spiritual harm, from the evil one. The Bible tells us that we have an enemy, an adversary called Satan, the devil, the evil one. Throughout Scriptures, the devil is portrayed as a deadly serpent, a ferocious lion, and even a multi-headed beast. He first appears in the form as a serpent in the Garden of Eden, where he repeatedly tempts Eve to eat the forbidden fruit. He convinced her to break the one and only rule that God gave by making the fruit look and sound so tempting. That's what Satan does. He uses every means at his disposal to lure believers into sin in hopes of sabotaging their salvation. And the truth is, we sometimes fall for his schemes. We do sin. But John is assuring us that Jesus is bigger and stronger than Satan, and he's got our backs. When we put our faith in Christ, he washed away our sins, past, present, and future. We're safe from whatever Satan throws at us. No matter what temptations or trials or tests come our way, we can know for absolutely certain that Jesus has our back, that he's looking out for us, and he will protect us from Satan's spiritual assaults. Christ has set us free from sin and Satan. So even though we still mess up fairly often, the ultimate victory is ours through Christ Jesus. So we can be certain about our promise, our prayers, our protector, and fourth, we can be certain about our place. Here's what he says in 1 John chapter 5, verse 19. We know that we are children of God. I want you to know that you hold a very precious position, a priceless place in God's eternal family. Isn't that incredible? God wants a family, and he created you to be a part of it. The entire Bible is the story of God building a family who will love him, honor him, and reign with him forever. The Bible says because of his love, God had already decided to make us his own children through Jesus Christ. That was what he wanted and what pleased him. That's Ephesians 1 verse 5. When we place our faith in Jesus, God becomes our Father. We become His children. Other believers become our brothers and sisters. And the church becomes our spiritual family. Christians aren't just called to believe. We're also called to belong. We're not meant to live Lone Ranger lives, be an island in the ocean, a pie in the sky. Rather, we're created for communion and community. Being a part of God's family is all about togetherness, laughing together, crying together, and dreaming together. In fact, the Bible says that Christians are put together, joined together, built together, members together, heirs together, fitted together, held together, and will be caught up together. There's a whole lot of togetherness in God's family. I think especially at times like this, when you're supposed to isolate yourself and avoid social gathering, it's easy to feel lonely and cut off from others. But when you belong to God's family, you are never, ever alone. Our families on earth are wonderful gifts from God, but they're temporary and fragile, often broken by divorce, distance, growing old, and inevitably by death. On the other hand, our spiritual family, yeah, our relationships with other believers will continue throughout eternity. We know that we are children of God. That's something you can be absolutely sure of. And finally, John gives us the last truth of which we can be absolutely certain, our Prince of Peace. He closes his letter with these words, verse 20. We know also that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know Him who is true. And we are in Him who is true by being in His Son, Jesus Christ. He is the real God and eternal life. Now, just so that you know, the word translated true or real means the original as opposed to a copy. The authentic as opposed to a imitation. Jesus is the true light, the true bread, the true vine, and truth itself. He is the original. Everything else is a copy. He's authentic. Everything else is just an imitation. In short, Jesus is the real thing, and that's all that really matters. Pastor and author Tony Campolo recalled a deeply moving incident that happened during junior high week at a Christian camp. Even though it was a Christian camp, many of the campers were not Christians, and many who were didn't act like it. They treated another one of the campers, a boy with spastic paralysis, with heartless ridicule. Whenever he would ask a question, the boys would deliberately answer with halting, mimicking signs. One night, his cabin group chose him to lead the evening devotional before the entire camp. It was just one more effort to try to updo him and run him in the ground to have fun at his expense. Unabashedly, the boy stood up that evening, and in his strained, slurred, stuttered manner, each word coming with enormous effort, this is what he said. I know Jesus loves me, and I love Jesus. That was all he said. But no one laughed. There was absolute silence, broken only by the sound of some of the boys beginning to cry. Something wonderful happened in the hearts of the campers that week. And it was all because of this simple testimony. I know Jesus loves me, and I love Jesus. Isaiah called Jesus the Prince of Peace. When you know Jesus and you know that He loves you and you love Him and you can experience the peace that passes all understanding even in the midst of a global pandemic. We're living in uncertain times, but in 1 John chapter 5, the Bible gives us some truths that have stood the test of time and that we can know for absolutely certain. We can be certain that of our promise and our prayers and our protector and our place and our prince. So when you feel overwhelmed or worried or anxious, remember these five certainties. Take refuge in them. You can know that you have eternal life. You can know that your prayers are heard by God. You can know that you've been vaccinated against sin and Satan. You can know that you are a child of God. And yes, you can know Jesus Christ, Son of God and Savior of your soul. Now, for those of you who don't know Jesus, I'd love to introduce you to Him today. He stands ready to receive you, to forgive you of your sins, welcome you into His family, give you the gift of eternal life. And if you're ready to come to Jesus, I'm going to ask you to pray with me. This Palm Sunday can be your new beginning. As you speak out, Hosanna, let Him save you today. Would you pray with me? Father God, I need a Savior. I thought I could do this on my own. I thought I could weather the storm. I thought I could overcome the virus. And yet, I can't. I can't overcome the virus that's killing me called sin. I need a Savior. I need you, Jesus. I need you to come into my life. I need you to sit on the throne of my heart. I want to cry out, Hosanna, rescue me, save me, wash me clean of all my sin. Be my Savior today and every day. I confess that I am a sinner and I need someone to save me. Save me, Jesus. In your precious holy name I ask this. Amen. Friend, if you prayed that prayer, know that you're part of the family of God. He welcomed you in with open arms. He's in your heart and life right now, and He'll never leave you. Please, always stay there. Believe the promise of the Word. He promised. His promises are true this day and every day. Listen, friends, we want to be in contact with you. We want to help you on this walk. We want to keep doing this with you. So if you have made that commitment to Jesus Christ today, would you simply text 97000, 97000, and type accepted into there. We'll be in contact with you because we want to walk with you today. We want to celebrate with you today. You're worth it. You're valuable in the kingdom of God, and this is the day, your day, it all begins. We celebrate. Thank you for being with us today. God bless you. As you go today, go with His blessing. The Lord bless you, and the Lord keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you, and the Lord look upon you with His favor. And this day and every day grant you His peace. Amen.